Hi, welcome to Subway.
Foot long Italian.
Would you like it on white or wheat?
It's Italian.
White or wheat?
Sorry, white, toasted.
Okay.
It'll be a turkey with
provolone.
Bacon. No cheese, just bacon added.
Okay.
Yeah.
Toasting the bacon. Okay. Well, I got. Oh, what else, what are your fixings?
I'd like some lettuce.
Okay.
I'd like some tomato.
Okay.
And I'd like a bukkake of bell peppers.
Oh, bukkake of bell peppers. Oh!
Hello, beautiful people. It's Tuesday night, and that means it has got to be go time for Night Attack, bringing you the best of the worst of the internet ever since anybody was paying attention. Hello, beautiful folks. I'm Brian Brushman, live in Austin, Texas, joined by my inimitable co-host, the one, the only, the JRY. What is up, Justin Robert Young?
Oh my God, Brian, we have a hell of a show for everybody today. Normally the show is a festering waste of nonsense, but this show, unlike every other show we've done, is going to be the golden example that we tell our grandchildren about.
Well, we're gonna get little Sisyphus and put him on my knee, and I'll say, you know, your old granddad, he had one. Like one good show. He's like, Dad, Grandy.
Here's a rock. Go push it up the hill, LOL.
All right, get Atlas over here. Listen up, Atlas. We had one. You're like, I know, Granddad. We can watch it on the internet. We still have the internet. I'm like, let me tell you how it went. The year was 2016. Granddad, nobody talks that way. It's like, yeah, I do. All right, no.
He said, shut up, as he accidentally and absentmindedly spilled his whiskey into the young lad's eyes. It's speaking of absentmindedly spilling whiskey into young children's eyes, let's welcome our guest, Jason Murphy!
Huzzah!
What's up?
Yeah, for those of you guys who don't know, Jason Murphy, my co-host on The Modern Rogue, also on Hacking the System, also back from an incredible adventure. What all do we have on the docket today, Justin? Do we just want to jump right into his tale?
No, we're just going to get into Jason's story. There is one thing I do want to, because I kicked myself right in the ass last week, rather. I didn't plug. We had this whole contender thing that I had set up just so I could plug it for Night Attack people. I totally didn't. We totally blanked the entire show, and I just tweeted it out afterward. But I want to make it up to everybody, so I left up the half-off contender base deck code that we were running during the debates. So if you want the contender base deck for 50% off, Vegas is the code at checkout. You can get it for 50% off right now. I'm probably going to shut it down in the next couple of days.
Vegas,
but just go get the base deck and
named,
code Vegas.
Named for the first most popular album by the Crystal Method.
Of Vegas?
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, no, Vegas, right? This is
checking out.
To
this
celebrate.
No, yeah, I was, for whatever reason, I didn't hear it because of the ducking, and I'm like, wait, was there another Crystal Method album called The Contender?
No, it was Vegas.
I remember Vegas. all right, so go ahead. Jason, you, people were running up and down 6th Street last week saying, where's Jason Murphy? He was not to be found in Austin, Texas. Where were you?
We checked all the bars. You're not in any of them.
I know. What are the odds? I was in Los Angeles, Hollywood.
Yeah, name one thing that was happening there during that time. Name one friend of ours, friend of the show, who name one guy who's written one Marvel movie, who went to a red carpet premiere and invited and flew you out to join him. Just one. Can you name just one?
Yeah. Robert Cargill.
Yeah, I guess that's
what
true.
What did he do? What makes him so goddamn special?
He had a dream and it involved a guy working at a deli.
What?
Yeah.
Hey, by the way, that's a great example because that was a callback joke to something happened in the pre-show. You can get the pre-show and the post-show if you subscribe to our Patreon.
I gotta remember.
Smooth. We're gonna get them one way or the other. All right, look. If you guys don't know, Cargill's been a friend of ours for a very, very long time. It's been amazing to watch him quit his day job as a reviewer and become actually part of the media conglomerate machine as he sells script after script. And by all accounts,
Doctor Strange.
How funny is that, by the way? It's like, oh, finally, throwing off the oppressive yoke of reviewing movies on the internet. He's now embraced his true passion.
Having been that guy who reviewed movies on the internet, it is an oppressive yoke. The dream is a lie.
I'm not saying it's not. I'm just saying it garners zero sympathy from anyone you tell it to.
I feel like next time we're on a Modern Rogue shoot, Jason's going to be like, I'll lose all my pinkies before I go review another anything ever.
Oh, yeah. I did it for like a year, and I was like, this, okay, sidetrack.
Go
reviewing
ahead.
Movies for a year. It was on a website that was all about horror movies
right.
and horror-related things, and
Bless child.
What's that?
Bless you.
Okay.
Bless
you. I know, right? And I was doing it for fun. I had a good job at the time, and I was just like, yeah, you know, get some writing experience, et cetera, et cetera. And I was getting $125 a month.
Well, hello.
Yeah.
Hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Yeah. Do you realize?
A month.
Are you writing weekly? So you're going – so the way that movie reviewing works is usually Tuesdays, sometimes Wednesdays, they have press screenings for – the movies that
by the way, he gets to attend for free before anybody else. So let's not discount that.
Although
part.
Many of them are also radio promos, which means you are in very weird crowds very often. It's not a quiet little private screening by the studio.
It's a hellscape.
Are you writing every week for $120?
Every day.
Every
what?
Day?
Every
what?
Day.
Is See, that, so that's news, too.
Oh, it's also news,
okay.
Which is basically regurgitating press releases, right?
Yes.
And so I was doing this for the experience and everything.
Man, and Brian, I thought the Twit host rate sucked.
Yeah. So I was doing this with a lot of people who are still doing it. Now, the industry has kind of collapsed. There are some people who are still doing it, but I was doing it. It was for a lesser-known site. It's not around anymore. And it, I got $125 a month. And one day, like, enough people didn't post. Like, I didn't post, and a couple of the other people who work for the site didn't post. And the editor-in-chief just comes after us.
Yeah.
And
he goes on Twitter, takes it public. He's like, well, I don't know what's wrong
with
reviewers today.
He sends this excoriating email, and he says, $125 a month, that's more than enough for a post a day.
What? From everybody? No, it's not.
He sent that out to everyone. I was just like,
That's $4 a post, people.
Yeah.
You sit down, you type. That's a Wendy's value meal just appearing. All you have to do is type. And I don't ask a lot.
I spent
for one thing.
I spent more time typing out and deleting snarky responses than I ever did writing for that site again after that email. I was like, yeah, I'm good. I'm good.
No, that's fine. That's a good time for everybody, you know. Listen, I am currently underpaying people to write blogs, but the one thing I'll never do is get on them if they don't do it.
Yeah, right.
So Cargill quit. I guess when I say quits his day job, he actually had an actual day job. Yeah.
No, I remember when Cargill was working at Hollywood Video.
Yeah. No.
You do too.
Yeah. Well, in fact, it was at Adam Sears' wedding that I sat down and I was like, look, man, here's what I've done over the last 5 years. I'm now a touring full-time professional. You know, Bonnie kept the lights on. I said, give me 1 year. Let's try to make it happen. And then like 2 days later, Cargill's like, hey, man, I just want you to know. I'm sorry. He goes, hey, so I just got off the phone with Robert Rodriguez.
That's better.
And then I was thinking about what you had to say because I'm about to call my good friend Harry Knowles, I think I'm going to do the same thing. And then he did.
And he did. Yeah. Well, yeah. He did movie reviewing for a long time. He slaved away in the crap mines, whatever you want to call
the
it.
The crap mines.
Yeah.
I mean, his writing as Masterworm was the first like interaction that I had with anybody long before I met Brian, of course, long before I met you. I read Masterworm on Anacle News. I was like a loyal Anacle News reader.
You said the first interaction you had with anyone. I'm picturing you emerging like you were found by Liam Neeson in a cabin out in the middle of nowhere. Your parents had died there. And the first connection you get is Cargill. And that's really
that would explain a lot.
The animated picture of him as Jesus with Dr. Pepper's with the cigarettes hanging out of his mouth.
That's right.
So I guess then all of a sudden I hear that Cargill has a movie, and it turns out that it's a real movie, a movie, and with Sinister, right?
Yeah, if you say it three times, that makes it real. Movie.
real movie.
Yeah. No, Sinister is his first one. Yeah.
Right, and then he's writing books, Dreams and Shadows. We had him on, mm-hmm. and then we catch word that
and then he decides to start going on his friend's podcasts and talking about things. Turns out that was less of a good idea than all the other ideas previous.
Hey,
but then he starts doing Doctor Strange.
Have you noticed he hasn't been back for a while? Have you noticed that?
You want to know what? Good move.
but... oh, geez. That's echoes. So I guess we're at the point now. And of course, I am... a little bit busy with kids and family and stuff, so I don't see Cargill nearly as much as I'd like, but you guys have kept super tight.
Yeah.
And so I catch word from you. I'm acting like I heard it through the grapevine, yeah. But it was you who told me that for his red carpet premiere, he had a couple of plus ones.
Yeah.
And he picked you and Rod and flew you guys out?
No. Rod flew us out.
Rod flew you out?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cargill set up the plus ones. Rod flew us out.
So, okay, first of all, how giddy were you? Like, how surreal is it the moment he tells you, hi, this property, I'm Cargill?
Well, you know me. I mean, it's like when we shot Hacking the System, which is on Netflix right now, and you should rate it 5 stars. as soon as I mentioned it, I thought, well, I should just turn it into a plug. Even while we were filming it, I was like, well, it's probably never going to air.
Wait, really?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. No, I had to keep that from you, though.
because I was already broken in enough other ways that, yeah.
You were like at peak stress.
A little bit.
And so I, as with everything else, I was just like, it'll probably never air. You know, they'll film it and then put it on a shelf somewhere. And so I was just like, something's going to happen and I'm not going to get to see Doctor Strange. So you thought
even heading out there that for whatever reason you have this Charlie Brown brain that's like, well, I bet you they're just going to be like, let's show Ant-Man again instead.
That's me.
Going to be invited.
I didn't believe it until I was sitting there in man's Chinese, and then it started to hit me, and I was just like, oh, this is like a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
Now, and this has some double surreality because that was where, like, you walked out the red carpet on the exact same spot where we shot one of the segments for Hacking the System.
Oh, I thought about that. I was going to bring that up tonight. I was like, Brian, have you ever walked down Hollywood Boulevard? Oh, yeah, actually, we shot an episode there. Well, you did. I walked down there, and it was really hot, and I wasn't in the scene, so I went up to Sammy Hagar's Cabo Wabo Cantina and had some margaritas.
God damn it.
Because it was like 100 degrees.
It's the story of the shoot. all right, so you find out, God, all I remember about that whole show is me sweating and you being in the air conditioning.
I want to get my hands on those outtakes that it's just Brian, like,
oh, geez, a super cut of all that. All right. So
here's all I remember of that shoot is that you guys, I mean, you're talking about Brian in peak stress. I would talk to Brian and you'd have like, you know, those like scenes in action movies when somebody gets shot, but they want to frame it in a certain way that like the first three words out of their mouth are normal. So you're like, oh, they survived the shooting. And then it pans down and they're like bleeding out of their gut. Right.
Yes. Like,
I'd have these conversations with Brian and be like, hey, man, how's it going? And Brian would be like, oh, fantastic, man. No, it's great. Yeah, we're shooting everything. Everything's fantastic. I'm like, oh, yeah, well, what are you up to? He's like, oh, I'm leaving the doctor. My life's slowly falling.
Yeah, I mean, it really was. It was like that. It was like, I'm not feeling my fingers, and I don't think that's a thing.
Yeah.
That,
yeah.
That's not
aside
right.
Aside from the fact that I'm having phantom limbs, although my limbs are still attached, I think everything's going to be fine. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Mom, tell me you love me. I'm just saying everything's going to be fine.
That's when we watched Edge of Tomorrow is when you told me. And you were the movie was over, and you're like, I can't move my arms.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
wait,
what is it? I'm like, what is...
Oh, did you never hear about
this?
Oh.
Is this okay to
talk
about?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, go for it.
You lost functions of your arms?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
When the movie, the credits roll, and he was like, I can't move my arms. And I was like, what is, what does that mean exactly?
Oh my God.
All right. Well, to give context, like, first of all, we're getting ready. We're literally moving out there. We stayed up the whole night before, Justin, doing Captain Morgan bits. We stayed up till 2 a.m. doing Ice Cold Opens with Captain Morgan. And then I slept for like an hour and a half and then went to the airport and then slept like, I don't know, 20 minutes on the plane or whatever. But like, I didn't realize in my mind, stress and panic attacks were not a real thing. Like, I'm like, right. Yeah, it's all in your head. Just calm down. Everything's fine.
You just decide not to.
Right. Exactly. My fingers begin to go numb and I'm like, well, this isn't like any of that fake stress stuff. This is a real thing. My fingers are actually numb. And then it's like I would go to, and you're right. It would like, I could move my arm if I thought about it as a robot appendage where it's like up. Okay, it went up to the left. Okay, it went to the left. And I think I'll grab, I have a cup. Okay, no, this, I guess. Almost. But then meanwhile, the whole movie long, I'm thinking like I'm a magician and I can't use my fingers anymore. And it's like I am experiencing, wow, of all the times to have this right before we're shooting it, all that stuff.
What if it happened to your wiener?
By the way, strangers never been easier than never mind. Sorry. Sorry.
By the way, what an 80s hacky like retort, by the way. Like, but what would have happened to your wiener? Am I right? Hey, everybody, all the gentlemen in the audience, let me hear you.
Yeah, that would suck.
Oh, my God.
So, at any rate, yeah, no, I was a wee bit stressed. But, okay, so you
wait, get... What's the end of that story? You got it back?
You
slept it off?
I
got help. You went to a doctor.
Yeah.
He at the very least legitimized it in your mind.
Sure. Well, and I was like, hey, am I dying? And the doctor's like, well, what's going on? It was like, well, I'm in town to shoot a show. Also, we went independent with podcast and also we're doing this and all that other stuff. He's like, well, how much sleeping? I'm like, yeah, I'm not so much sleeping. It's real hard to sleep.
The doctor says, yeah, you're totally dying, dude.
Yeah, no. he totally was just like, Jesus Christ, here, have some Xanax. Get the fuck out of here. And then that was that. And everything was great ever since.
He's been doped up ever since. Yes.
And that same prescription saved my ass one day.
Oh, it did?
Oh, yeah.
Did I give you a Xanax?
You did.
Wait, when was that?
That's illegal. Yeah.
Let's just discuss our drug deal that we did.
Yeah. No, it was after we saw that guy get mowed down.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah.
Y'all talked about this on the show.
Yeah.
We've handled it. But like, we saw a guy get run over and he was mangled and it was terrible. Hope he's all right. Hope you're all right, Richard. Hope you're out there and you're watching right now.
It turns out he's our biggest fan.
Yeah.
He's like, these guys saved me.
Yeah.
But, and then they went and did a shoot where they had a wacky hot 4th of July party.
Exactly. But when we got to the party.
I've recovered so well that all I ever wanted was to go see the premiere of Doctor Strange.
I hope Jason got... Oh,
no.
I love you, Richard, but no.
That guy the Xanax.
Yeah. No, at the wacky 4th of July party shoot that we had at the fancy house... Brian walks up to me and he does this and I'm like, we're fist bumping right now? Is that what we're... And you're like, no, open your hand.
And you're like, what is happening?
I was like, I thought we were fist bumping. I don't know why, because it's been a shitty morning. And you dropped a Xanax in my hand. I was like, oh, God bless you. Oh, my God.
That's a hilarious fictional account of what might have happened if we engaged in anything illegal. Which we, of course, didn't.
It was actually Pez.
Hilarious twist ending.
Yeah.
We hope you've enjoyed this presentation of Fictional Drug Dealing with Brian and Jason.
This story has been called, it was actually OxyContin.
So, where were we? All right. Well, hold on. First of all, like, did you expect Cargill to invite you to be his plus one for freaking red carpet premiere?
No. I expected it to be, you know, him and Jessica, his wife.
Yeah.
But he texts me and he says, I was at home working and I'm sitting on the couch on my laptop and he texts me and he says, hey, we should game some more when you get back from your business trip. And I was like, yeah, sure. But, you know, Rod's on the business trip. I'm home. And he's like, no, no, no. On the business trip that you're about to go on.
Oh.
And I was like, shit. Should I be packing? Is there like a job trip that I'm supposed to? Oh, man. What am I blanking? And I'm sitting here. And I'm just not getting it. He has to spell it out for me. He's like, no, dummy. You and Rod are going to be my other plus ones to the Doctor Strange premiere. Congratulations.
And so, okay, so when that happens, like, how big of a rush is that? Is that just kind of like, oh, that's cool? Or is it like, holy shit, this is a childhood dream come true?
Yeah, I mean, you know me, huge Marvel fan.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, of course. Well, and specifically of Doctor Strange.
Yeah, yeah. I've got the Doctor Strange toys and all that stuff. Yeah, I love the character. When he secretly told me that he was writing Doctor Strange.
He wrote it in all caps. Hear ye.
Yeah, exactly.
All those receiving this tweet.
Yeah. No, when he told me, we were out on his back patio and I had like a crumpled up pack of cigarettes in my hand. And he told me, I'm going to be writing Doctor Strange. And I just threw it at him. It was like, what? And there was profanities. And I was like, I'm so happy for you. If you need any information right here.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So
he didn't need it. He knows his stuff. So, okay. Yeah, so, he didn't need to call me at all.
No, I don't doubt that at all. So, okay. So you and Rod hop on a plane. Did you guys all fly together? Or
no, no. Rod was already out there.
Okay.
He was out there working already. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I flew out like the day of, literally the day of the premiere on, flew out. Worked for several hours,
right? Well, I mean, it was a business.
It was a work day.
Yeah, yeah, you have to make it. You have to.
Wait, hold on. What'd you do? What are you doing in L.A.?
One of our clients is out there. Software stuff.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. So, we were like trying to finish up this meeting, and I was like checking the time, like. We gotta be somewhere.
Oh, because Rod's at that meeting too.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're like, Rod, am I the only one who's freaking out right now?
Yeah, I was like, we gotta go.
That carpet's not gonna red itself. You have to spill the blood of some virgins.
Oh, no, yeah, no. There is nothing more terrifying in Los Angeles than being 3 hours away from something that you need to do opening ways.
Oh, like, yeah.
Any moment, that can go from 45 minutes to 5 hours. There's no telling what that devil app is going to tell you it's going to take to get from 1 mile from where you are to 1 mile west.
Yeah, and we were reasonably close, but I was sitting there like, the closer it gets to like 4 o'clock, the closer we're going to get to like it turning into the trek to Mordor.
In my mind, you're literally on the next block over, and you're just like, where is my Uber? How am I supposed to get over there?
Yeah, so...
Because you don't want... The ultimate is you're late, the movie's already going, you know, all the press is dispersed, you're running up to the theater, you open it, all the light from the back of the theater shining onto the screen, and you have Stan Lee turn to his left and just say... Great job, fucko.
I would have taken that. I would have been happy with Stan Lee calling me fucko.
Yeah.
I would have been like, I don't even need to see the movie.
He's my new superhero. He's called Fucko Man.
Here's a picture. He tweets me. What if Stan Lee just trolled me for the rest of his life?
Like, oh, no.
Hey, remember when you showed up late? Great job, fucko.
That's his name. Turns to one of the Playboy playmates on his arm. He goes, hey, this guy, he showed up late for one of my movies. That's why I named him Fucko.
That's the post-credit stinger of him mocking a picture of me. Look at this fucko.
Fucko will return in Guardians of the Fucko.
If you'd like more information, refer to Fucko issue number 2.
True believers?
Excelsior!
So, fucko! Okay, so you've never done one of these red carpet things ever, right?
Oh, no, I've done like 3 or 4.
You motherfucker. Have you really?
Fucko.
Yeah.
Yeah. No wonder Stan Lee calls you fucko.
No, I haven't.
Oh, okay.
No, I've never done that.
Well, no, so okay. So you show like how does it go? Because I was watching Cargill's tweet stream.
Yeah.
And he was I'm seeing tweets with that he took of The Rock and
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
With The Rock?
I thought it was The Rock.
I don't believe that happened.
Oh, no.
Although might be a little bit racist. No. He had a little plush doll that was his date, quote unquote.
Oh yeah, that he was caring for this this.
Oh, maybe he was grabbing from previous stuff. He wrote evidence that my date is so much cooler than I am. And then I thought he was taking those pictures. There you go. Yeah, right there. Right, that's The Rock, right?
Yeah, but that's not Cargill with The Rock.
Okay. That's in a house. That's in a home.
Well, actually, it looks like a mobile, like a trailer.
Yeah. This is an NFL locker room.
Is that man wearing Richard a
shirt? Yeah, no, it looks like he's spreading a kilt for us. Okay. It's not right.
Hey, I don't know who that is. Bing, bing,
bing. So those are just older photos.
Yeah.
That's fine.
I was like, I don't remember.
All right.
So hold on, wait. I'm confused now. So you're telling me that the premiere wasn't held in the Seahawks locker room or the Rock?
You never know, man. So, okay. So do you see Cargill at all during this entire time, or you guys just go your separate ways?
Well, we didn't see him. Okay. So we walked down Hollywood Boulevard, right? Because we were staying like just a few blocks from the theater.
Mm-hmm.
And we walked down Hollywood Boulevard and you've been on Hollywood Boulevard, but have you really walked down Hollywood Boulevard and taken it in and all of the smells that may or may not kill you?
I mean, apparently not, because I think you were there at the time.
If you could see anything through all that sweat, you know, maybe.
Yeah, all right. Some of us weren't drinking a margarita in the air-conditioned Cabo Wabo lounge.
Fair. Yeah, it's a singular experience because when it comes to mentally disturbed homeless people, L.A. is bringing its A game.
Oh, my God, dude. Yeah, wait, was that one dude there that you know? Were you there? That guy?
Talking about Fucko?
No. No, you're Fucko.
I'm Fucko.
No. There was that one guy who's apparently a regular, like Mr. Muscles, I think his name is, and his catchphrase, he goes, "You know?" And then
I know. I missed that.
He just marches up and down. He makes a brief appearance in Hacking the System during the credit sequence.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Now I got to go back and rewatch that show.
No, you don't.
Okay. But no, we walk down there, we stand in line, we're in the suits and line with all these other suits, and then we got to go through a metal detector, we go get our badge, and there's lots of people there, we see the red carpet, and there's like this giant, like, sphincter
I think we have a photo of it.
Yeah.
Hold on.
That's
artist.
Cargill, also a giant sphincter.
There we go. This.
Yeah, that thing.
It's like the portal. It's the portal from the movie, right?
Yeah, it's the portal that all the sorcerers use.
The giant flaming anus.
That's the one. Yeah. So you walk through that, you know, and so there was a part where if you look along the sides, every news media organization you can think of.
Yeah.
I mean, and a lot that you can't even imagine.
Sure.
Just like all over the place, right?
Yeah.
And so you're walking along, and at one point, there's the place where they stop and take the pictures, right?
Sure.
There's the place where celebrities stop in front of, you know, the big logo, and here's the sponsors, Ferrari sponsored or whoever, right?
Right.
And as we're walking up to it, there's a security guard standing there, and he sees me and Rod, and he just motions, and we walk behind that.
Like, you can't be one of the beautiful people?
Yeah, because then they might think, oh, well, they must be important, so let's take their picture.
Oh,
yeah.
And now, do you think...
At that point, I'm like, see, Rod, here's where they give us our aprons, and we're like, would you like another canapé, Mr. Cumberbatch?
Yes. Anyway. So, okay, so do you think it's just that you guys weren't carrying yourselves like somebody who was part of the team?
Brian, come on.
I'm just saying.
I was the
cock. No, wait a minute. Hold on, wait. But is this security guy, like, has he memorized IMDb?
I don't know, but...
Like, nah, man. You go behind. That's the dude who wrote Fantastic Four too. He goes in front.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I mean, I don't believe that. I think he just caught you guys a little too timid.
Yeah.
And he's like, they don't look like red carpet material.
I should have turned to him and been like, Black Oak Motorcycle Club?
Yeah,
Modern Rogue?
Yeah. I wrote Fantastic Four too.
The original Corman one is actually what I wrote. But yeah, I don't know. It's like, how did they know? I mean, maybe there were only like a handful of people that were on the approved list.
Yeah.
And like, you're not Mads Mikkelsen. You know, you're not Stan Lee. So.
All right. So you get through to
Let
the other
me
side.
Through, fucko.
So you get through to the other side.
Yeah, we get through to the other side, and then we walk up, and they won't let you bring your phones in or anything like that. And so,
wait, you have to like throw your phones in a bucket or something?
Yeah, you put them in this sealed bag, and they give you the bag. And
oh, the Dane Cook thing or the Chappelle thing.
What? Yeah, no, yeah, this is like a new thing where like, yeah, Chappelle is doing it, but yeah, it's this company that I'm guessing is LA-based because this is always where I read about it. That, yeah, exactly what you said, that you put it in a sealed bag that, like, only unseals when you, like, physically leave the place or whatever.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what it was.
How does it it know?
I think you have to go by and they, like, wave a wand over it or something.
Okay, so it's you can't, it's magnetically sealed.
Yeah, exactly. Right, so we had to put I didn't even bring mine because in the invitation they said, you know, leave your phones. Said you'll be forced to check them, but we highly recommend that you leave your phones. And so I did. And I was like, yeah, fine, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we go inside, and Man's Chinese is the most gorgeous movie theater I've ever set foot in.
No kidding.
Oh, it puts the Paramount in Austin to shame.
Is it as racist on the inside as it is on the outside?
Oh, totally. Yeah, super, super racist.
Okay.
Yeah, a lot of murals of Mickey Rooney.
If the movie theater were to talk, like, how would it sound?
It would sound like Mickey Rooney in Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Oh, well played. Well played. Yeah, he just...
A little sidestep.
You just
like
Bruce
that?
Lee'd.
Who's the fucko now?
Yeah.
So, okay, so
well,
you walk...
I'll tell you what. How about this? Imagine Jason Murphy sitting in the gorgeous and opulent Man's Chinese Theater as he's about to watch one of his best friend's work appear on the screen, as you then go to patreon.com/nightattack to support this show. Brian, what do people get if they support patreon.com/nightattack?
They get their very own RSS feed. We'll send a link to you that gets you both the show and the pre-show and the after show. Now, the pre-show and the after show is not as structured because we're a very highly structured show. I think we've made that very clear.
Yeah,
but
we structure the shit out of it.
But some of the best moments that we come up with are in the pre and post show. And I'm not going to lie, it's a big pain in the ass to go over and watch them on YouTube. You have to sit at a desktop computer or whatnot, or you have to press play on your phone and then turn it so that your thigh doesn't pause it while you're trying to go. Dude, forget about that. Get all of that stuff. As a matter of fact, let's play my new favorite game.
Yeah, we got a new bit here for the Patreon.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Night Attack new Patreon name chant corner hour.
Hour of it. Thank you to Stephen Cogswell for that.
Stephen Cogswell. You know what? Sometimes I think that maybe it's not a real name when somebody gives us money, but you know what? Anyone who's my boss, I ain't going to question their name.
No.
I'm going to say thank you for the $1 per episode, Laundry Scent.
Laundry Scent.
Laundry Scent.
End. Laundry Scent.
Laundry Scent.
Their name was Laundry Scent.
Laundry Scent.
Laundry Scent. Laundry Scent. Laundry Scent. Laundry Scent.
Laundry Scent. Hey, thank you so much.
Thanks for the buck, fucko.
Yeah, man, look, you guys get double or triple the show, and it, hot damn if it doesn't keep Tuesday nights my favorite night of the week, and that's the most important thing. Please, won't you help keep this my favorite night of the week? I'm afraid it might become Wednesday, but you can save that by pledging at patreon.com/nightattack.
And fuck Wednesday.
Yeah, no, fuck Wednesday.
Yeah! All right, so,
I have an announcement. Can I get a similar announcement?
Sure.
Okay, so many of you already probably know I wrote a novel a while back called The Black Goat Motorcycle Club. Mm-hmm. It's available on Amazon. It's a horror novel. Brian has been on my ass for a while now, gently on my ass. Said, hey, fucko, where's the audiobook?
Yeah, fucko. And then behind me, I say, hey, fucko, where's the audiobook? And Stan Lee's like, yeah, fucko.
The first episode of the serialized audiobook went up today.
Oh! So, okay, so where do we search? What do we do?
You can find it most easily on my website, jasonsmurphy.com.
Well, is there an RSS feed? Like, if you look in the iTunes store, your favorite
It hasn't posted to iTunes just yet. It's on SoundCloud, and it should be up on iTunes within the next 24 hours.
All right. Bryce, let's take a little listen.
Yeah.
Firefox is frozen.
Firefox is frozen.
Jason.
Yeah.
Have you recorded all of it and you're cutting it up, or are you recording it as you go?
As I go. I should have done all of it, doing it as
I'm
I go.
I'm just going to tell you. Listen, I'm Jason Murphy. We did this. This is basically what, like stoked Andrew's career that has now published, like, 3 or 4 books. Knock all the rest of it out.
Mm-hmm.
And basically what your gambit is to everybody who's listening to it bit by bit is you'll always be able to listen to it bit by bit. But whenever you want to tap out and just get the rest of the story, you can go ahead and get it at wherever.
Oh.
Yeah. Yes. Well, that was actually the original plan, but I've had some trouble getting recording all lined up and everything. And then Brian said, hey, come on Night Attack. And so I said, I got to get it out before I go on Night Attack.
Yeah. No, I rushed. It's fine to do what you're doing.
Yeah.
But if you need any help with it, I mean, I've done 5 or 6 of these. So
thank you.
Just let me
know. Also, you have access to a premium Millennium Falcon class studio that almost works half the time.
Is that?
Hey, can we take a listen? Yeah. I want to hear Jason.
Flickered across the trailer. The lights danced over vintage posters of The Day the Earth Stood Still, Message from Space, and The Blob. Next to the more action figures, some classic, some new, stacks of DVDs and Blu-rays, vinyl of 1950s Hawaiian music, jazz, The Animals. Through the haze of incense and the clouds from his joint,
I just want to believe. I want to believe this ends with him saying, "Like that's a list of things I like." I'm Jason Murphy.
A little obvious, huh?
Yeah, a little on the nose. That's fine. It's
exactly.
Fine.
Yeah. Jameson, jerking off with your left hand, going to see your friend's movies at the Man's Chinese Theater. These are more things that I like.
These are a few of my favorite things. But yeah, and I have a Patreon for it, which I'm going to give like a author's commentary every week for each thing that I read, where I dissect it probably more than you want. And you get the next chapter before everybody else if you're a patron. So.
That's patreon.com/Jason Murphy.
Yep.
Oh.
I found you.
Who will
Thanks,
be
buddy.
The first?
Yeah.
The first.
I literally
live.
Launched it just before I headed up here.
That's nice. Amazing.
I mean, listen, number one, I'm very excited that you have it. But Christ, Jason, like doing your homework on the way to school. Come on, man.
I know. Well, I've been busting my ass for the last like 48 hours to get that
hey,
done.
Hey, man, he walked all the way down that red carpet. He sat through all 2.5 hours of that movie, man.
As he was sitting at Cabo Wabo and saying, man, I've really worked pretty hard today.
And then they said, hey, Fucko ordered another margarita.
I love the idea that it was there's just always a Stan Lee cameo for any Jason story, where it's just like pans over to the bartender of the Cabo Wabo on Hollywood Boulevard. Like, you want another drink, Fucko?
All right, so you make it down the red carpet. Did you have any awesome celebrity encounters? You don't have to dish out of school.
No. We went in, we got seated. And like total noobs, Rod and I were the first people in the whole theater.
Oh, you thought it was about seeing the movie. Like, you're the only two people there that are like, I'm really excited about seeing this movie. Yeah. I don't got
Better
time to give hand
seat,
jobs to
bro.
Random. Wait, what's that?
Better get good seats.
And so before the movie, they're playing like this Marvel live stream hosted by these two talking heads. And they're like, oh, so-and-so from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is here. So-and-so from this is here. And blah, blah, blah. Here's Mads Mikkelsen, who's in Doctor Strange. Let's talk to them. And it's right outside.
Yeah.
We're sitting in there watching, sipping from our free tiny Diet Cokes. Like, watching it. Right? And I'm like, oh, okay, there's that person. And I'm like, ha, okay. And then finally, someone else enters the theater and sits down next to us. Dan Harmon.
What?
Wait,
what?
Wait, who?
Dan Harmon.
What?
Yeah.
So tell me, you like walked over and started freestyling for him, right?
I went, wubba lubba dub dub. Yeah, so we talked to him for a while.
Wait,
super cool.
Wait, you did? You chatted with the...
For quite a while. Yeah, he was great.
God damn.
Yeah, he was really cool. Him and his girlfriend.
Can I tell you for reals? Like I thought I was not going to experience the jealousy bug. But then
Was it right now? In that moment,
he was great. I liked him a lot. He was just really down to earth and everything. And yeah, we talked to him for quite a while.
God damn, get out of my house.
It's
over.
Long, elongated. Yeah. Like, I'm sure that if you ran into Dan Harmon in the next week, he'd be like, oh, yeah, great. We had that great conversation.
Yep.
Yep.
He would totally remember it.
Right?
Totally remember the two clearly out of place guys, Rod and Fucko.
Out of my studio, Fucko. No, that's amazing. I can't believe you held that.
He's
from
there
me.
Because he did punch up stuff on.
Yeah.
On right?
Correct. Yes.
I still don't know what it is, but the story was when he opened up a file at San Diego Comic-Con, there was like something labeled Doctor Strange, the part where he fights surprise villain that nobody expected. And it was like that was the file name on his desktop, yeah. Basically.
Apparently he was involved somehow. Maybe it was just feedback or something like that, but I don't really.
Was his name in the credits?
I think pretty much everyone on Earth was in the credits because they lasted like 10 hours.
Yeah.
And no, I think, like... well, Marvel's fairly famous for doing like, I mean, the idea that famous script writers will do punch up work is nothing new, but I think he probably filled a lot of the same role that, Will Ferrell's, Adam McKay, like Adam McKay punched up Ant-Man. Like,
right.
Like Marvel's famous for doing 90 different rewrites of everything that they do. And oftentimes... the last will be they'll get like these like script doctory these people to go do it, which is why they hired Joss Whedon for so long, because he's like a famous Hollywood script doctor that just comes in and does those last little tweaks.
Yeah, and a lot of times they'll bring in somebody funny, you know, to punch up the humor.
Right.
Because that's really kind of where everything is trending right now, especially after Guardians of the Galaxies and all of the blowback on the DC films. So. That's probably what it was.
Those little winks, like from what I, and again, I've only heard scattering little things, but like basically like whenever the script starts to get tedious, they do a great job of backing up and saying how strange this stuff is.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's
the self-awareness, basically.
Yeah. And you want to do that, you know, plus then they've got to be like, okay, well, we know what we're going to do with Black Panther in the future. So let's give it to someone and say, hey, can you work in this Black Panther reference into this movie? You know, so it's like, so it all feels interconnected and like it's laying the groundwork for the next movie.
Right. Okay. So you go in, you hang with Dan Harmon.
Yeah. For like an hour.
I mean, are you a fan of Dan Harmon, Brian?
No.
It's fine.
Who's Dan Harmon?
It's fine.
Yeah, I'm not really familiar with his work. Like, what? How would you describe? How would you describe your relationship to Dan Harmon?
Fuck you,
Brian. Put your boner away.
All right, like, name your top one favorite podcast.
All right. First of all, it's no secret that I love listening to the Harmontown podcast, but specifically, like, I've dug Dan Harmon's work before I even knew who he was, because I fell in love. I must have watched Heat Vision and Jack, the 1999 pilot, half a hundred times.
Yeah.
It's unreal. Like his type of writing and everything, which is, it's ironic that I've never given the chance to actually, Kevin Smith and Dan Harmon are in that weird category of people that I would rather hear them talk about their art than actually experience their art. Just because, like, I understand, like, the process is what I'm so fascinated with, and the honesty and the earnestness in both of them. They both have a talent for disabling filters in a way that I could only aspire to.
That was heavy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Dan Harmon's the one from NCIS, right?
So.
No, you're thinking of the guy from Summer School.
I know. I stole that from J.C. Calhoun anyway. Okay, so you are in the theater.
Yeah.
You talk to Dan Harmon. Any other star sightings? Any other like, ooh, is that The Rock or Richard Sherman?
You know, I watched everyone going by on the screen, and I was like, that's cool. The only time that I freaked out and thought, oh, I got to get out there. I got to get back out there so I can meet was actually Stan Lee.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
You're like, it's me, Fucko. And he goes, kid, that's a bit you're not going to write for 2 more weeks. I'm Stan Lee. And then he flies away.
Yeah, exactly. Don't worry, you'll get it in 2 weeks, Fucko. Disappears into the portal.
So, yeah. And then the theater filled up and we watched the movie. And it was really good.
Did they make you sign an NDA? Like, theoretically, could you right now spend the next 90 minutes giving us a beat-by-beat explanation of everything that happens? I'm not asking for it, but I'm saying, like, could you?
Yeah.
All right.
There's nothing preventing. Is this going to be a Patreon extra?
No, Jason will spoil Doctor Strange for you beat by beat if you subscribe to his Patreon. Patreon.com/Jason Murphy.
That's right.
All right. Well, here, let me.
He works at a deli.
Give me your favorite part about, because I know there's a lot of people that are excited about the movie or have tickets for it already. What is your favorite part about the movie, and then maybe something that you weren't thrilled with?
Okay, my favorite part of the movie was actually probably the cloak. And that's just off the top of my head, but the cloak, you know, Doctor Strange's cloak.
Every time he flips. Yeah. Well, we've seen like the animated GIFs of him walking and he just like a badass whips the cloak around.
That's the tip of the iceberg.
Yeah.
It's super cool.
Yeah.
My least favorite part of the movie was that, and this is probably...
In the middle of the post-credits scene.
Stan Lee! Hey, fucko!
Talking to you, Jason Murphy.
Right
you're
there.
Did you know Fucko?
Hey, Dan. That guy right there. No, it was... this is probably has something to do with my knowledge of Marvel Comics in that I called all the beats. I was like, oh, they're going to do this, and they did, for the most part. You know?
Yeah.
It was still good and really entertaining.
That's just the curse of knowing. Like, once you've experienced that battlefield enough, it's like, you know, it's like, well, this is that.
Well, it was his origin story, too.
Yeah.
So, and that's not even really a complaint. It was like, yeah, that's exactly how I would have done it, you know?
Yeah. But here's the important thing.
This, like, worthy story that has delighted people for decades.
Yeah.
Made a worthy version of it for visual consumption,
and,
right?
And I have to tell you, as I tweeted the other day, I thought I was jaded to visual effects and that you couldn't impress me, but it kind of blew me away.
Yeah, well,
this is what I want to ask. 3D or not 3D?
We saw it in 3D, and it was the best 3D I have ever seen in my entire life. Now, that's probably going to be
Bonnie showed up.
Oh, Bonnie.
Bonnie.
Oh, one eye.
Bonnie.
I didn't think of it. Yeah, it is the best 3D I've ever seen in my life, but that's probably going to be dependent
any
on.
3D would be the best 3D. Oh.
Yeah, Bonnie, you've got the wrong attitude. You got to be more like Brady, who just says, all movies are 3D for me.
It's probably going to be dependent on the theater, because most theaters you see 3D in, they don't, you know, change the bulbs, they don't do it right. So it's like, if you go to a theater that is equipped to do 3D right,
digital,
it's going to blow
all right,
you
so
away.
Normally digital IMAX is kind of a lie because it's not actual IMAX.
Right.
Do that for this, because especially for 3D, the lighting is so much, the contrast is so much brighter that it's going to pop. Here's the deal. I went to go see Suicide Squad in 3D because it was the only thing I could see it before I was going to catch a flight. And Doctor Strange, the trailer that I had seen and liked, like, I thought it was good, but it wasn't like knock you on your ass. I saw it in 3D, and it was like all the levels of how much they cut out. You realize how lazy most 3D transfers are, that it's just like, no, the one rock that's coming at your head is cut out. But everything else is just kind of one flat layer. The trailer was one of the most amazing 3D experiences I've ever had, which made me, for the first time ever, skip a better-for-me timed 2D showing so I could get a later-in-the-night 3D showing for Doctor Strange on the Friday that it comes out.
And the imagination that went into all of these, like, Steve Ditko-esque Doctor Strange, you know, head trips, it's like, oh, Inception? That's adorable. Watch this shit.
Yeah,
and it just, like, blows your mind. It was the poster for it really should have been one of those magic eye posters, I think. Like in the mall where you sit there and just kind of stare at it.
It should actually just been a pop-up book where you're just like yeah. folding things in and out like an accordion. Yeah.
So was Dan like impressed?
Did Dan like it? Did Dan Harmon like it?
I didn't talk to him.
Oh man, if only Brian was here so I could.
You guys went to the drawing room like, afterwards. I hung out with Jeff Brian Davis.
I didn't.
Then he started freestyle rapping everywhere he went. It was amazing.
I didn't talk to him afterwards. I don't think. I might have said like, "Hey, take care."
But was he leaning forward in his chair like this?
Yeah, I was, so I didn't notice what the hell anybody else was doing. Yeah, it was a good experience. It was great.
You're killing me. You're killing me. All of you are killing me.
Hold on. So show ends, right? Everybody's buzzing because this movie is going to make $1 jillion because I own it in the movie.
Hey.
But do you go to the after party?
Yeah.
God
I did.
Damn it. Was Dan Harmon at the after party?
He said he was. I didn't see him, though. He said he was going to be there. I didn't see him. But yeah, the after party. I got into the Magic Castle.
You know what?
Finally.
It's probably Oh, whoa. Oh, shit. I didn't know this. Okay,
yeah.
Justin, do you know that Jason? All right.
Got turned away.
No, okay, first of all, you did not get turned away.
I got turned away.
No, all right. He got reminded.
They said no magic for you, fucko.
No.
It's me, Stan Lee. I work at the Magic Castle now.
God damn it, Stan.
So while we're shooting,
it's abracadabra at the bookcase, fuck off.
So we're shooting Hacking the System, and we decide to go to the Magic Castle, and they do have a stupidly strict dress code. They're all about that stuff. And I forgot what it was that you were wearing.
I had like suit and tie, or jacket and tie, nice shirt and everything, but I had left my pants.
So you didn't have fancy pants. You had like denim,
I had some nice black denim
or something. Yeah. So I was like, well, you know, maybe they'll let you through or whatever. But then they get there and the guy was trying to be nice.
But
Jason was a little on edge. The guy's like, oh, unfortunately, you're wearing denim. You can't wear denim. And he's trying to say that store over there has acceptable pants. But Jason's just like, all right, well, I'm going to a bar that wants my money. And then turns around and just marches off.
Not what I said.
What did I say?
I did lose my cool though. I totally lost my cool.
You're like, okay, well, I'm leaving.
Which wasn't his fault. I was just frustrated at the situation because I did the math and I was like, okay, there's no real cell reception in there. And I don't want to make everybody wait for me while I run down the H&M on Hollywood Boulevard and buy some pants, change into those. What am I going to do? And the whole thing was just like, it was like me assembling IKEA furniture. I was just like, never mind. And it was totally me just like losing my shit. But I was like, you know what? Nope. You guys have fun. I'll talk to you later. And Brian was like, hey, what? Like, nope.
That's actually pretty accurate.
That's what happened. Yeah.
It was.
That was the first time in a long time I had just lost my shit.
So
that sounds like, I mean, listen, you guys have always kind of had this like dude Walter Sobchak kind of relationship. That is a crystalline example of it, right?
That was a reversal of the roles. So you finally got to go to the Magic Castle. How much magic did you watch?
Oh, none. I was like, why the fuck do I want to watch any magic right now?
So the party was at the parking lot of the Magic Castle, right?
It was both. You could go into the Magic Castle and see the shows and stuff like that, and you know, go through all the, you know, cramped labyrinthine staircases and stuff like that with the secret shelves. It was cool. It was neat. I just didn't really feel like watching any shows at that moment. By the way,
Brian, do you know who was performing at the Magic Castle during that time? Carl Hein, who we ran into randomly Saturday night at Dragon Con.
Oh yeah, wonderful. Dude, he was so cool. What was he dressed as again?
Green Arrow, I believe.
Yeah, that's right.
We had no idea he was going to be there. I had actually just seen him like 2 weeks ago at the Magic Castle, and like all of a sudden we are just getting like faded after the Night Attack show. We're in our matching Kim Jong-un, Kim Kardashian, like,
you know what, you're jealous.
BMX racer tops.
You're jealous of Dan Harmon. Yeah. I'm jealous of the Kim Jong-un.
Look, you could walk out wearing that shirt. I'm just saying, dreams can come true. Well, that's great. So was the party good afterwards?
Yeah, it was really cool. Magic Castle was interesting. It was really cool. You walk in and you... Am I allowed to say this? Are you going to knife me or something? Like, requiescat empache if I say how you get into the thing?
No, yeah, well, yeah, you say open sesame.
Yeah, to the little owl bookshelf? Yeah. And it's, super awesome.
Yeah.
That was badass. Yeah, yeah. But it's filled with magic panhandlers.
Yeah.
Where they're like, hey, would you guys like to see some magic? It's like, I'm having a conversation. No, you can't wash my windshield. Stop. Oh, he's reconnecting the rope. All right. Go do your goddamn wizardry.
Well, I think that's also a specific issue because, like, I'm going to take a wild guess based on very limited knowledge of what I know of the Magic Castle. But periodically, they do get rented out for gigantic events like this, right?
Yeah.
So they probably were overstaffed for the crowd that was there, which meant there were more people who wanted to show a magic trick than people who probably wanted to, like, watch a magic trick, considering the fact that, like, normally the Magic Castle is this amazing thing where magic, maybe, like, magicians together in a private club of magicians, maybe one of the most, if you are not into magic, nerdy and off-putting things you can be around, right? The Magic Castle is both a legit tourist destination and cool place where hip Hollywood people hang out.
Yeah.
And a place where nerdy magic people only talk about magic. It's amazing. But for that, where it's literally just, nope, we're all here just to perform for people, that's a problem. I can see where that might have gotten a little...
Well, no, I actually genuinely felt bad for those guys, you know, because they were there, like, trying to show their wares and everything. And it was probably a big opportunity because might see them.
Keep in mind, that's one of the appeals to performing at the Magic Castle. Like, when I was performing at the Magic Castle, you better believe I definitely lived for that moment that I walked out to do my set and saw Marilyn Manson sitting front and center. I'm like, I'm performing for Marilyn Manson, and he's laughing. Eli Roth, I think, was there that same week.
Yeah, he was.
But, okay, so you go to the after party.
I mean, there's no Dan Harmon. I mean, if you could pick either Marilyn Manson.
I swear to God, don't make me freestyle a rap.
And open bar?
By the way,
bar, ain't it?
Real quick, I noticed that in the chat.
I did hang out with Dan Harmon at the. I'm just kidding.
God damn it. What?
I didn't.
Although I would be surprised because they've shit talked the Magic Castle on Harmontown a few times.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
He said he was going. I didn't see him there though.
Yeah, he also has said he likes to lie about what places he'll go. I mean, I don't want to say I'm the one who listens the most to the Harmontown podcast, but. So I noticed in the chat that Hannibal Montana is in the chat, which I don't always see him here.
Yeah.
But he put together. Well, I think I'll save it for the after show. But we've got to play that incredible epic cartoon. Bonnie hasn't seen it. Bonnie hasn't heard it. The Bee Gees.
Oh God, that was good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. We'll save that for the after show.
No, we got to.
What are you talking about?
Which you can only get.
Subscribe to the Patreon, patreon.com/nightattack.
I'd like to raise my hand and say you should listen or read or go and subscribe to the patreon.com/nightattack.
Yeah, I agree. Hey man, shall we take a moment and do a little bit of diamond time?
Wait, are we already there?
What? Dude, we're over an hour, man.
No, we started way late, though.
Yeah, I don't even think we're at an hour yet.
We're at half an hour.
What time do we start?
We're far into this show.
It was like 9:45, something like that.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah.
No. It was like 9:14 we started. Now it's 10:23.
Oh.
Okay, so you're at the after party, Jason.
Yeah.
Any other celebrity sighting during the after party or any? Do you sync back up with Cargill? Because obviously this is a gigantic moment.
Cargill actually sat next to me.
Okay.
During the movie. Yeah.
And so we rode over there. Hanging out the entire time?
Yeah.
Together?
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah. We, you know, navigated through the party and everything. And it was lots of people there. The inside of the Magic Castle was cramped. Then you go out to their parking lot and it's set up very nice. They had, you know, open bar and lots of little snacks and hors d'oeuvres and stuff like that. And it was a fantastic time. Everyone I met was exceptionally nice. Very cool.
Except for
Cargill?
Wait, really?
No. Oh. No, of course not. Was,
yeah, fishing. I'm just fishing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, as long as we're fishing, we're like, Jason, why is it that they changed his mentor to a Celtic woman?
No. Hey, nope. Welcome to Diamond Talk.
All right. Well, here's the only last thing that I do want to ask you is there's got to be that moment where you have, I mean, it's kind of been like canonized as like that entourage looking out into the abyss of the current success and enjoying the moment. Was there a singular moment with you and Cargill that you had that moment? Did you get to experience that one little jelly bean of joy
where he looked at me and called me turtle?
He's like, you're the dumpy one. Yep. Doesn't matter how fit you are.
Yep. Yeah, there is where he we were sitting there or we were walking up to the Magic Castle and he goes, what did I tell you 7-8 years ago? It's all true.
Oh, God.
And I was,
see,
like,
that's yeah. That smug Cargill called shot. Cargill, I was like, what is with this guy? This is before we became friends, when I was just watching him on the Real Deal on cable access. I was like,
and hanging out after the show.
You know, yeah. Who is this guy who just drops all these names all the time? And then it's like, yeah, but it's all legit. It's like, God damn it, it is. He really is friends with Meghan McCain.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
God damn it, you beat me to the Meghan McCain joke. I was going to say, when Cargill drops names, like, you should ask Meghan McCain about that.
Yeah.
So that was it? The moment was Cargill saying, like, no, I told you. Like, I talked to everybody. I am everything. You better learn the new law.
Yeah, we were walking up to the Magic Castle, and I was like, and that was a conversation we had like 7 or 8 years ago, and I knew exactly what he was talking about. But yeah, it was, and then afterwards, the party was only from like 10 to midnight, so it was really short. And after that, we went back to the Roosevelt, which is this classic, gorgeous hotel right across the street from Man's Chinese. And we drank there for a while, and we went up to Cargill's room, and there may be pictures of me passed out.
I mean, dude, if there's a place to get hammered and pass out, it's going to be at Cargill's.
Yeah, but I didn't embarrass myself. At all, I don't think. I did introduce myself to Carl Urban twice in the course of 60 seconds.
Did he call you out on it? He's like, yeah, no, you definitely just introduced
yourself. No, I said, I was like, I just introduced myself to you. He's like, yeah, don't worry about it.
Nice.
So, yeah.
Hey, Justin.
That was a great little, like, last second.
Just a little bit.
Drop. That was great. Because, like, we got the entire time, and it was just you and your friend, and you're enjoying it. And then the last second, anyway, Carl Urban. By the way, move on. Yeah. Here we go.
Oh, I've got pictures with me and Dan, actually.
Do you really?
No.
Oh, good. That made me sad.
See, I didn't want to get pictures with anybody because I didn't want to be that guy. I just wanted to be cool and respectful. But now I'm really wishing I got pictures with me and Dan Harmon. I did get his number, though, so.
Is this a real thing? That's
I need that as a gift. I need that second as a gift. That 1 second. Somebody gift that 1 second of Brian turning to Jason. I need that. I need that. Oh my God, I need it. I need every second of it. There was 2 seconds. I need them both. But because Brian's, like, mouth slightly opened, and then he turned in this, like, ruthless fashion of, like, you fucking really good, son.
It's like
It's like the guy that always has a crush on a girl, and then his buddy moves in. You know?
Brian, I totally finger banged Dan Harmon in the back of my Camaro.
Diamond Time is the portion of the show where we shout out your projects right here on Night Attack. The top three sticky, just go on over to diamondclub.reddit.com, put in your submission, and the top three will get read right here on the show. I'm Morpheus. Writes, right, hi, super nervous, but here goes. Submission, one, Jesus, is this an outline?
Can you please write it like we need to read it?
This is a business bullet point outline.
Okay.
Is there a PowerPoint coming?
okay, look, let's just take it line by line. Ready? It will go on the round. Me, Jason, and then Justin. Ready? Submission.
A project, a defunct podcast titled Mixtology.
Tagline, one part alcohol, one part storytelling, one part debauchery.
Number two, involvement.
I was really sick for a while. Then I sort of got better.
I realized life was short. I
reconnected with my sister.
Created a podcast with her.
Reasons, three reasons to check it out.
Is it funny?
I just want someone to listen to it and get a good laugh out of it.
Four, Link Mixtology, where lies and libations get served neat. Best listened to under the covers where no one can hear.
All right, look, I'm done. Too obtuse. Basically, go to Mixtology. That's MIXEDOLOGY.XYZ, and you can listen to an awesome podcast.
By the way, the Link Sheriff, California Carl, just comments, wow, that's a good link. Discs of Tron says, whatever accent you want. All right, Jason Murphy, what accent? What accent are we doing?
Scottish.
Okay. Greetings, programs. I'm Stephen Cogswell, a fat guy on the internet. Well, I have a new album of not-so-Night Attack material out now, and as a gift to the Diamond Club community for a limited time, it's absolutely free. Go to stephencogswell.ca. Or if you want a shortened link, go to yolo420.com/bit.ly420. YOLO swag, canal, root, gin, and tonic. Enter zero for a price. Seriously, people, it's not all that hard. Also, to make things easy, you can use code YOLOSWAG420, NAP Jury Christ at checkout to get some bucks off. That means you can get 30 hours of music, my entire life's work, for only less than a dollar, only 94 cents. Wait, why am I doing this again? The Night Attack stuff is always at awtfy.com/nightattack.
Speaking of which, new release. Can we listen to last week's release?
Oh, yeah. He sent us a song.
Yeah. awtfy.com/nightattack is where he has a tendency. It's like spinning the roulette wheel. You never know. And I get excited every single time.
We had some tech problems.
No, we were having an awesome party. So awesome.
Diving in the back. Sunroof top. Chilling on the scene with a gangster lady. Generic American.
Ding dong in the flip flop.
Generic American. Generic American.
Please just copy.
I'm ready, ready, ready.
Brian, if you would only read the subtitle on this cartoon I'd like to show you, that you would understand how foolish you are, pumpkin.
All right, well, here, let me take a look here. It's got a dog building the pyramids. Looks like somebody has a tablet, and he says, where's the homepage?
No, I swear to God, like, and I am not saying this flippantly or lightly, that might have been the best constructed joke you've ever had.
Is this still happening?
Yeah. All right, guys, show some love to Stephen Cogswell.
Yeah. Hey, by the way, did you forget that Stephen Cogswell was a goddamn murderer who just, like, murders everything that he touches? Because if you forgot that, then I hope you were reminded and you all go buy his album.
He's like the King Midas of
murder.
Every murdered corpse he murdered, he turned to gold.
Ryu Planeswalker writes in saying, hello, great stars of the internet. With October coming to a close, I thought I would toss my own project into the fray. Once a week, I do a Twitch stream I dubbed Late Night Let's Plays. I usually stream from 4 a.m. to 6 or 7 in the morning EST. You insomniacs out there should come by and hang out. However, if you're not up for the live stream, I always post the videos on my YouTube channel at tinyurl.com/videogameswag. Thank you, Bonnie and Neshcom, the true stars of Night Attack, for giving me a chance to promote my content.
Aww.
Welcome. Look at that. Stop shouting them out. We're the stars. no, that is great.
I wonder if he plays any games people have heard of.
Wait, like what? What's he playing right now? Kaladesh?
Kaladesh, Eternal Moon.
Magic Duels.
Yeah.
Backlog.
Final Fantasy V.
Oh, okay.
Breath of
Fire.
Yeah. Breath of Fire. Heard of it.
Breath of Fire. Good.
Two years ago.
I'm in. Hey, man, do we have a Movie Draft Minute?
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of October 24th. 2016. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. It's a brand new season. We have some familiar faces this time, but who will come out on top? Time will only tell. Let's see how everyone's doing this first week. Milongo AE, Mikey Newman, Team DTNS, Justin Robert Young, and Brian Brushwood are all tied for second place. Still waiting for the first film. And in first place, Jack Reacher, Never Go Back, bringing in $24.7 million this week. It's Christy Cates. And that is your Movie Draft Minute for the week of October 24th. 2016.
All right, Jason.
Yeah.
So I'm going to draft.diamondclub.tv right now, and I'm looking at the results of the movie draft. By the way, if you guys want to play at home, you have 72 more hours?
You have until Friday.
Yeah, you guys can spend money at the rates that we've said. Don't be a douchebag and set names like Brian Brushwood 1, Brian Brushwood 2, Brian Brushwood 3, Brian
Literally
Brushwood
no 4. Literally no one was doing that.
I mean, not my name, but their own name.
No. Somebody was doing like four different things. Oh, we're going to delete three of the four. So just
one entry per customer. Thank you very much. But you could spend money and figure out what we overpaid for and underpaid for. But here's the question, Jason.
Yeah.
Who's going to win between option A, Trolls, Kidnap, Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, Resident Evil, The Final Chapter, versus this other slate, Arrival, Sing, Gold, Hidden Figures, The Founder, XXX, The Return of Xander Cage, 50 Shades Darker, John Wick Chapter 2, and Logan?
Option B.
Really?
Yeah, I think so.
How much money? Because I think Rogue One's going to make all the money in the world.
I think it's going to make a lot of money, but you've got several mid-tier ones like 50 Shades Darker, John Wick, and Logan.
And Arrival.
The problem. The problem is that you're thinking about this in summer movie terms.
I do have a bunch of base hits, but winter does tend to be the case of feast or famine, right?
Yeah. There are very few summer movie grossing movies in the winter. And what you would think of as, it's like, XXX. Maybe that just does 150. Maybe that does 200 in the summer. In the winter, that might do 75 just because there's less people out there going to see movies.
I'll tell you what, man, I'm glad. I know it was a little bit messed up that we were late, and we apologize. Some of us had to run off to Europe to do some epic drinking and hanging out with.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Did you see Dan? You saw Dan, right? He told me he was hanging
Dan
out with you.
Armin? Yeah. We were hanging out the whole time. We were like, my God. I thought you just saw Jason. That's so funny. We're all great friends. Did you just see what he said in group chat?
Oh no, I didn't.
You kill me.
He's got the cutest stickers online.
Yeah, all right, stop.
I love his line stickers.
Stop, all of you, stop.
They're so cute.
All right, true story. If I had met and talked with Dan Harmon and was friends with him, Brian, the show would be done. The show would not happen anymore.
Like, so you're just going to go hang out with your new best friend, huh?
That would be it. It would be done.
Throw the table. Roadhouse.
Fine.
Shouldn't you be at the meltdown?
Like, if I ever meet Dan Harmon, the first thing I have to say is, you need to meet my friend Brian. I'm going to FaceTime him right now. I'm just going to FaceTime just so we're all friends. Or else the show, this
you make it sound like we're all friends, but the moment it comes up, you're like, hey, Brian, look who I'm with. Fuck you! Which, by the way, you exactly did with the guy who wrote The Martian, Andy Weir. Like
that was true. I literally did that. Brian could not stop talking about how much he loved this book, The Martian. I had not read it, I met Andy Weir, and the only thing I said is, I don't know who you are, but my best friend loves you, so can I please flip him off with you in the picture?
I gotta find that picture.
I'm gonna flip him off with you.
Damn, I wish I'd
amazing.
I just feel like Brian's such a fan that if he ever met him, he'd be like,
I would totally.
It'd be like, oh, Chris Farley on
have
him.
You guys seen MacGruber?
No.
Nobody seen MacGruber?
Hey, man, you know what I have seen is the Fantastic
Show.
Join
the rest of America.
It's funny. It's a funny movie.
It's actually supposed to be a really good movie. It was one of those cases where they did everything right except for sell tickets.
Yeah. It's a funny movie.
You know who loves the movie, apparently? Christopher Nolan.
Yeah?
Christopher Nolan loves MacGruber.
That's hilarious. You know what else is hilarious? Is the lunatic adventures of two jackasses at themodernrogue.com. Head on over to youtube.com/modernrogue or themodernrogue.com and watch Jason and I make total asses of ourselves.
Thanks, Brian.
Hot damn. It feels really, really good to have this this thing launched. I'm so nervous about it, and I obsessively check all the numbers every day. Please tell all your friends. We're in it for the long haul. We want the Modern Rogue to do really, really well.
Can I say something serious?
Sure.
I'm extraordinarily proud of both of you.
This is a
YouTube channel that not only exists because you guys can do really, really well at this content, but because nobody else will be able to do the content the way that you guys want to do it, right? And so much of this relies on your guys' chemistry. Every time I watch an episode, it is better than the last one. The entire team, Bryce, Brant, the two of you, you guys are just doing an amazing, amazing, amazing job. If you have not checked it out, you need to do it immediately. It is awesome.
And don't forget, pre-order pricing, I think, only has like 24 or 48 hours left if you go to scamstuff.com. We've got 3 Modern Rogue t-shirts. Did you like the designs? How they came out?
Yeah, they were classy.
Yeah. So we got 3 different t-shirts modeled on the 3 different aspects of the Modern Rogue, the Warrior, the Gentleman, and the Scoundrel. Those are available right now if you go to ScamStuff, and I think we're about to see a picture of them. We're really proud of them. What about you, Justin? What you got going on?
Well, I already shouted out earlier, thecontender.us, if you want to get the base deck for half off. Like, I effed up, you guys. I pooped my pants, and I forgot to take this offer code down. So if you want it, I shouted it out on the morning stream, and then I was like, oh, I'm only going to do this for the morning stream. And I'm like, no, that's stupid. I shouldn't do that. Let me just go ahead and do it for Night Attack as well. You guys have been my A1 since day one, so go ahead and check it out. It is thecontender.us. Use offer code Vegas. Nashcom's doing it right now. Look at
Holy
that.
Cow. $15?
Off.
$15 for the full game?
That is you get a lot with the base game. That's really dumb.
Yeah.
That's 500 cards inspired by quotes from real presidential candidates or presidents themselves, spanning from George Washington to, I don't know, have you heard of him? Barack Obama.
And no
also
repeats.
Also, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump are in the base deck, so we're covered either way.
And no repeats. For a deck that large, you sometimes get repeats in games.
Yeah,
you got no repeats.
For what it's worth, look, you can either handle this right now or a month from now, you can be all like, oh, golly, Christmas is coming out. What am I going to buy all my friends?
Christmas
is
coming out in the movie.
Christmas is going to drop.
If you want to know how to get it signed, just email thecontendergame@gmail.com and say, please sign my deck, because I'm going to go fulfill all these tomorrow, and I'll double check it.
Also, my wife just launched her web series.
Oh, dude. Okay, can we just pick any random moment in it at all? You plug it. I just want to see a random clip because you showed us just a random moment. I'm like, oh, my
oh I
God.
Did?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Right. No, my wife, Allison, just launched her website. It's on superblogblog.com. She's doing weekly episodes, and there's like little weekly episodes. Then there's the monthly narrative episode that's part of the greater thing. And she also has a metal band that ties into it called
Thunderhag.
I'm wearing the Thunderhag shirt. Right
Thunderhag.
Now. Thunderhag.
If Tenacious D was a metal band with a chick as its front woman,
yeah,
then it would be Thunderhag.
It was, but it's like Amy Schumer does Pee-wee's Playhouse, only if Amy Schumer were really pissed off.
just play some stuff.
This is
Allison playing all of the roles.
I see you've sent the email.
Except for that
Have
one.
You completed the schedule?
Yes, but there's a problem.
There are no
They're
problems.
All
there are only opportunities for solutions. I want you to move forward with the project as planned.
Well, great. We'll schedule a meeting for Wednesday to discuss Thursday's PowerPoint presentation. And we'll tap who's gonna create that then.
Wait. There's one more item on the agenda.
The disciplinary write-up.
So she did all of this in our upstairs room.
Well, and you just see her come down, swap costumes, and then walk upstairs again.
Yeah, and that's what she really looks like, right?
Yeah, we're just gonna. The rest of this is just us watching.
Yeah,
the episode.
But it's super surreal and weird. It's like
that's amazing.
Dude, yeah. Here she is as a dude.
Hi, Chas.
Chas.
How can I help you?
I guess Sandra wants to see you in her office or something. Whatever.
He looks like a boy band. He looks like all parts of a boy band. In one person.
But yeah, she's got in the web series, there's this metal band that is her favorite band, right? And it's called Thunderhag. And so she needed some songs for it. And so she fronts Karaoke Apocalypse, right?
Right.
You guys knew that.
Which is a full live band. It's like doing karaoke, but you have an actual live band behind you
right.
that plays, and you're actually fronting a band.
And so she said...
And they're the reason why Hillary Clinton's going to win Texas.
Yes. she said, hey, guys, will you write some licks for me and a couple of snippets for this web series? You're a fictional metal band called Thunderhag and all that. And so they did that. And then they were like, no, we want to be a real band. And she was like, really? And like, oh, yeah, we want to like make an album and like play shows. And so they played at the premiere of the web series. And I had friends of mine like people that you guys might know, like Tony Guerrero and old metalheads coming up to me going, this is actually really good. Like, they were surprised. They thought it was going to be this joke, but it was an amazing show. It's like old school, like, it's like if Tenacious D met Black Sabbath.
Dude, that's amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, hey, Brian, I mean, might be a little early, but have we booked our musical act for South by Southwest show?
Can we book... Thunderhag.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Our next Night Attack
yes.
live.
Oh my God, yes.
I don't want to. I don't want to drop.
Bryce drops all decorum. He's like, yes, please. Can we? Can we please?
I don't want to drop any names, but I'm kind of sleeping with the lead singer.
All right,
so I think
we
can make it happen.
You slut. You slut.
Fingers crossed.
I'm such a fucko.
man.
Way to get it in, you fucko. I love how, like, the evolution of the yelling, heckling Stanley character as he eventually becomes your affirmation. Like that was way to lose 5 pounds, fucko.
he's like my Tyler Durden is Stan Lee.
All right, Jason Murphy, can't thank you enough for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Bryce, great job as always.
Thank
Bonnie,
you.
Thank you for poking in.
Sure.
Do you have anything to plug?
I don't know. Follow me on Twitter, and maybe one day I'll have something to show for
it. Yeah, you'll be able to show your hairstyle.
That's at Invisible Wife.
She did
tweet
it.
She tweeted it last week.
I got 100 people that put little hearts on my Twitter. Thank you, guys. That meant a lot to
me. It looks really good. I like it.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. I'm a bit bedraggled today, but.
More like bedrunkled. It's Tuesday night, eh? Oh, fuck off.
I don't know. Sorry, guys. It's down to the wire in the neighborhood, and we are, like, setting up the Halloween party, yo. And all the moms are, like, freaking out.
All the moms in the house say yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, look, love you guys. Everything that you, I do it for you. Yeah. See you next Tuesday.
Dying of fire. I'll let Dan Harmon end the show, Jason.
Oh, yeah. No, we'll make it happen.
Drop just a freestyle begun. Rap. Brian Brushwood. Every time you leave, I wanna hurt myself by pissing off some bees.
Oh, we didn't play the Bee Gees.
I'm allergic to
after
bees.
Show. Oh, after show. See if they go to patreon.com/nightattack.
They'll be right there. After show.
It'll be the first thing they hear. Young, every $1 an episode. It's all we ask.
I get so sad that I wanna. Drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack, night attack, night attack, night attack, night attack, night attack, night attack. I love.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.